I'm Gwendolyn Hooks, and I am the author of Planting Peace, The Story of Wangari Maathai. This book is a picture book biography, first because it's full of pictures on each page, and it's a biography. It's the story of someone's life. When I first heard about Wangari, I thought, I wish I had known this lady. But, and maybe you'll feel that way too. But instead of meeting her, you'll be able to read about her. Wangari grew up in Kenya in Africa, and she was an older sister to several younger sisters and brothers. She helped take care of them. But one thing that she could not do was go to school. But one day, her brother asked her mother, why can't she go to school? And her mother said, why not? So Wangari got a chance to go to school. In those days, when she was young, most girls did not attend school, especially Kenyan young ladies. When she went to school, she earned a scholarship that entitled her to fly to the United States and go to college here in the state of Kansas. In Kansas, if you have good eyes and look to the north, you just might see it because it borders Oklahoma, where I live. She stayed in the sciences because she loved them, biology and different sciences like that. After she finished her undergraduate degree, she went to Philadelphia and earned another degree. She wanted to learn as much as she could, not just for herself, but for her community, and especially for the women in her community. Finally, she flew back home. She told her parents when she would arrive, but she didn't expect them to meet her at the airport. It would be too long a drive from their farm to the airport. But when she stepped off that plane, who did she see? Her mother, her father, her sisters, and brothers. They were so happy to see her, and they were so excited for everything that she had learned in the United States. And Wangari decided she was going to take that learning and make life a better place for women who lived in Kenya. My first career was a math teacher. I loved teaching in middle school and a couple of years in high school. But one day I thought to myself, there must be something different I can do. Well, I loved going to libraries. My kids grew up in libraries during the summer book programs, and it was just natural. So one day I thought, well, maybe I'll try and write a book. And I did. It wasn't a biography like this one. It was an early reader, and I love writing those because they were fairly quick and fun. And kids seemed to like reading them. And I kept writing those. But I noticed when I went to the library and checked out books that I wanted to read, a lot of them were biographies. So my mind got to thinking, maybe I'll try a biography.
Planting Peace, The Story of Wangari Maathai by Gwendolyn Hooks, illustrated by Margot Carpenter and recited by Dino. The fig trees.
Wangari made her way through the forest to collect firewood for her family. She was at home in the forest and looked forward to gathering the wood. It heated the water her family used for washing clothes, cleaning their home, and cooking their meals. She enjoyed her peaceful walks, but always remembered her mother's warning, "Do not gather wood from the trees." She knew the ones her mother meant. Their roots spread out and burrowed deep into the ground, holding the tree firmly in place. Birds sheltered in the tree, eating the tasty figs. Why couldn't she have a taste of the figs too, Wangari wondered, or use its branches to heat water for their dinner? One day she would learn their lives depended on the trees. But as a young girl, she had no reason to think that the trees would not be there forever.
Welcome to the world, Wangari. On April 1st, 1940, in a small village in Kenya, a baby girl was born into the clan of leaders, Anjuru. She was of the Kikuyu community. Her parents named her Wangari. Wangari grew up among luscious green shrubs and tall leafy fig trees. The nearby stream's water was clear, clean, and fresh. It was the community's water. Arrowroots, bananas, and sugarcane grew along its banks. Sometimes the stream was full of tiny round beads. They were so beautiful, sparkling in the water, that Wangari tried to catch them. But no matter how hard she tried, they slithered and slipped away. Then one day, the round beads disappeared from the stream, and something new appeared. Now she saw rounded bodies with tails swimming peacefully in the stream. Before long, they also disappeared, and suddenly frogs appeared, hopping in and out of the water. Wangari had witnessed the magical secret life of frogs, and her lifelong fascination with nature began. A gardener of her own. One rainy season, Wangari's mother gave her a plot of land. Her mother taught her how to care for it, but it would be hers to till and tend and grow vegetables. Wangari planted sweet potatoes, beans, corn, and millet that she would grind into flour. Wangari was curious and then pulled up her plants while they were tiny to check on their progress. What were the seeds doing under the dirt? Were they growing quickly or slowly? If her mother saw her, she would say, "No, no, no. You can't remove them. You have to cover them. You have to let them do this all by themselves. Soon they will all come above the ground." And to Wangari's amazement, they did. The natural world continued to fascinate Wangari. She watched her plants grow, noticed the changes from season to season, and how each plant grew according to its own clock. School surprise. One day, one of her brothers asked their mother, "Why doesn't Wangari go to school like us?" Their uncle, Kamudu, sent his sons and daughters to school, but most girls didn't attend school. Wangari thought her mother would surely say no. Her mother still had young children at home. Who would watch them for her? Who would pay the school fee of 1 shilling and 50 cents? What a surprise when her mother announced, "There's no reason why not." Her mother made an unusual decision on her own. She didn't consult any of the men in the family, not even Wangari's father. She decided her daughter would learn just like her sons. Before she knew it, Wangari was enrolled in the Presbyterian primary school. She had no idea what to expect. On the first day, her cousin Juno walked her to school. Suddenly, he stopped. He asked if she knew how to read and write. Wangari did not. Juno pulled out a pencil and wrote something on a sheet of paper. Wangari's eyes widened. It was a miracle. She had never seen written words before. "This is what you will learn in school," he told her. Wangari never forgot the moment, the power of writing and reading. The miracle of learning. Primary school wasn't fancy, a dirt floor and mud walls under a tin roof. A wood fire warmed them during the cool months of June, July, and August. Over the next 4 years, Wangari studied math, geography, and another African language. At home, her community spoke Kikuyu. At school, she learned Kiswahili, the language spoken by the Swahili people. Best of all, she learned the miracle of reading and writing. She also studied English. Her English teacher would walk to the door. "This is a door," he announced. He walked to a wall. "This is a wall," he told them. Soon they learned all the parts of a building. When Wangari's time at primary school was over, she thought her learning was over. She knew Kenyan girls were not highly educated, if at all. Their role was to take care of the family. She would miss her new friends, her teachers, and learning. More surprises. Wangari's mother surprised her again. Wangari would continue her education at St. Cecilia's. Attending the school would mean a big change in Wangari's life because St. Cecilia's was a boarding school. Wangari would live at St. Cecilia's. She was only 11 years old. Could she bear to leave her family and the huge fig trees and her gurgling stream of frogs? But the chance to learn more about the world outside her village filled her heart and head. She would study hard. She would show what Kenyan girls could accomplish. Her mother gave her a short haircut so it would be easier to keep neat away from home. It was time to leave home and walk with her cousin to her new school. On the day-long journey, crossing a footbridge over the swirling Chania River, Wanguru noticed the many plants growing along its banks. It reminded her of her home and calmed her nerves. Eating fire. Wangari slipped easily into the school's routine, but sometimes there were mistakes, mostly due to language. Everyone in Kenya's schools had to speak and write English. For some, this rule resulted in misunderstandings. One student wrote a letter to her family saying she ate fire. In her language, she meant they were having a great time. Fire was not on the menu. For breakfast, they ate maize flour porridge. For lunch, it was corn and beans. And at 5 p.m., they ate their evening meal, ugali, a mush of cornmeal with vegetables. Wangari was an excellent student at St. Cecilia's and graduated at the top of her class. It was time to move on to Lorito Schools for Girls.
Fly away. After working hard for 2 years at Loretta Girls High School, graduation was near and school would soon be behind her. For young Kenyan ladies graduating in 1959, there were two choices open to them, teaching or nursing. Neither was appealing to Wangari. Surely there was another option. Wangari found it. The Kennedy Foundation had set aside money for African students to attend college in the United States. Besides paying their college fees, the fund also paid for their transportation. The United States was so far away from her family and her friends, she would not have money for visits home. Wangari's teachers considered her one of their most promising students. They encouraged her to accept the challenge. Soon she was on a plane heading towards the United States of America. The trip was long, but Wangari saw places she read about only in geography or history classes.
The never-ending Sahara Desert was awe-inspiring.
She dined on frog's legs when they stopped in Luxembourg. Frog's legs? She hadn't known that people ate frogs. Why not try them? She was learning so much, and she hadn't even started college yet. Can you imagine flying to a new country where you didn't know anyone? Follow Wangari's adventures in my book, Planting Peace.
Cockroaches and quails. At St. Scholastica College in Atkinson, Kansas, Wangari decided to study biology, chemistry, and German. The teachers were encouraging, like the ones at home, and after 4 years, she graduated with a Bachelor of Science degree. Keen to keep studying, Wangari moved to Pittsburgh to take advantage of biology classes. However, when her professor suggested she study the life cycle of the cockroach, she had to object. She imagined cockroaches crawling all over her. Her professor suggested she study Japanese quail instead. It wasn't a large bird, so it would be easy to handle, and it did not resemble a cockroach. Her assignment was to learn the purpose of the pineal gland and how the gland developed during the quail's lifetime. It meant she had to explain what the gland was all about. Wangari did it and earned her master's degree in biology. Kenya and Kenyatta. In the USA, Wangari led a peaceful life compared to unsettling news she was hearing from home. In 1963, after many years of British rule, Kenya gained independence. Jomo Kenyatta became the country's first president. He was Kikuyu, just like her. He gave Kikuyu people the better jobs. He banned anyone from voting against him. After many British people left Kenya, President Kenyatta gave their land to Kikuyus. This angered other communities. It was unfair. After all, they were all Kenyans too. Wangari listened to the president on the radio encouraging Kenyans to return to the rural areas. Grow coffee and tea like the British, he urged them. He believed selling those crops would help Kenya prosper. Would it? Wangari had been offered a job working with a zoology professor at University College in Nairobi. It was time to return home. What would Kenya be like when she returned? Would Kenya look the same? Would it feel the same? Wangari couldn't wait to find out. You have just heard the first half of the book, Planting Peace. A few questions for you to consider as you read the second half. Did Wangari win an international recognition? What did Wangari do to fight against injustice and encourage peace? Why was she arrested? Name two awards she received. And I will leave you with words from the author, Gwendolyn Hooks. As you turn the last page, think about what you can do to keep our environment productive and clean. Remember Wangari's selflessness? Remember how a small tree seedling can grow into a tree that will provide shade, food, clean water, and beauty for people just like you.
Now it's activity time.
Yay!
We're going to thank a tree. Because trees meant so much to the people of Kenya and all over the world, it's time to thank them. Think about a tree, maybe in your yard or your neighbor's, or one you might have noticed on your way to school. Imagine what your yard would look like if there were no trees, but you have some, and we need to thank them. Here's my letter. Dear Backyard Tree, thank you for your service to our family over the many years you've shaded our house. Your strong branches kept our son from falling when he ignored our advice. Stay out of the tree before you fall on your head or you break a leg. But you kept him safe. No head bumps, no broken legs. We will always be grateful. Enjoy this sunny day. Thank you, Gwendolyn.